So, welcome to Module 9 of SQL Server for Oracle DBAs. In this module, we will discuss managing schema objects. We will look at how we can, what are the guidelines and what are the rules that govern identifiers for our objects, what are the storage and structure of schema objects, and we will look at implementing integrity using both constraints, so declarative integrity, as well as implementing integrity and business rules using triggers. We'll also look at indexes and how having various types of indexes can benefit your query, including managing indexes at the partition level and creating indexed views. Let's start by looking at the rules for identifiers and naming guidelines for SQL Server. As you know, in Oracle, object names are generally not case sensitive. They can be made case sensitive if you use delimiters, but by default, they are stored in the system catalog in the uppercase. In SQL Server, the casing of the object names is preserved. But the default behavior is that the objects are not case sensitive. In both Oracle and in SQL Server, names have to be unique within a schema. So you can have two objects that are named the same, for instance, orders, as long as they are stored and belong to two different schemas. There are small differences. There are very small differences in syntax that is used to define your basic objects, such as schemas and table. Let's take a look at tables first. The syntax for creating tables in Oracle and in SQL Server is generic and comes from the ANSI standard. So there are very little differences. Most of the differences have to do with the various data types that we use on both platforms. When you define your table, components of definition for each column include the column name, data type, any default value, and optionally any constraints that should apply to that particular column. When it comes to managing constraints, there are five typical types of constraints found in both SQL Server and in Oracle. These are not null constraint, check constraint, unique constraint, primary key, and foreign key. Constraints can be defined inline together with the column definition. That applies to any single column constraints. Or out of line as table constraints. Any multi-column constraint has to be defined as an out of line table constraint. Primary key constraints and unique constraints are enforced by using indexes. Now, there is a very important small difference between Oracle and SQL Server when it comes to enforcing unique constraints. In SQL Server, any constraint values and in null values in unique constraint are treated as equal. Essentially, since two null values are neither equal nor different, we cannot guarantee that two null values will be different. Therefore, in SQL Server, there's only one null value allowed in a unique constraint or unique index. This is the opposite of what Oracle does, where in Oracle, only the null values are indexed, and therefore we only enforce uniqueness for non-null values. And you can have multiple null values in a column that has unique constraint defined. The workaround and the way to provide Oracle-like functionality in SQL Server is to use so-called filtered indexes. In SQL Server, you can create a unique filtered index where you filter out any null values. And a filtered index is essentially an index definition with a where clause. So if you create a unique index on a particular column where that column is not null, then your unique index will only apply to columns with non-null values, and any null values will be excluded. That behavior will give you, that filtered index will give you behavior comparable to that of Oracle. When it comes to primary key constraints, you have the same behavior between Oracle and in SQL Server because, of course, primary key constraints also are not nullable. So in both platforms, they cannot be null. Now, let me show you an example of using primary and foreign key constraints to enforce referential integrity between two tables. So in this demonstration, I will show you how I can define a table with a primary key and use a foreign key from another table to validate data against this this primary key table and see how a violation of such constraint gives me an error and rolls back my transaction. So in this scenario, I have a table called sales tax rate. In the sales tax rate table, I have various types of taxes defined, and there is a tax type column there that allows to me to describe what type of tax it is. Right now, the tax type column has a constraint defined on it. It's a check constraint. So I do have a check constraint against the tax type column in this table, and this check constraint makes sure that the tax type is between 1 and 3. So basically, I can only have tax type 1, 2, or 3. That is, of course, not flexible and probably not the best solution for my database. I would like to improve this database design and create a separate table where I will be storing definitions of tax types and validate the tax type column in my sales tax rate by using a foreign key. In order to do that, I will disable and drop the check constraint that I currently have on the tax type column and create a new table called sales tax type. The sales tax type has just two columns, the tax type column, the tiny integer, and a name column that is of type name. So it's the name type in this case is a user-defined data type that is equivalent and synonym to nvarchar 50. So I'm creating a table to store those tax types, and this table will have a primary key constraint. This constraint will be enforced by the clustered index, and primary key constraint is on the tax type column. So when I create this table, I have to pre-populate it with some of the tax types that are already exist in my sales tax table. So I already define tax types 1, 2, and 3. And now with this table populated and three rows stored there, I can modify my sales tax rate table to create a foreign key referencing that newly created table. So I will be referencing tax type column from the sales tax type table using a foreign key on tax type column in sales tax rate. So I create this foreign key constraint, enable it, make sure that it is enforced, and now I can try to see if it works. So to test if it works, I will try to create a new type of a new tax, new sales tax rate with a tax type of 4. Of course, there is no tax type 4 defined in our table. So when I run this this query, this insert statement, I get an error and my transaction gets rolled back. So this statement is terminated and the transaction rolls back. So the problem, of course, is that this insert statement conflicted with that foreign key constraint and the tax, basically I provided a tax type value that was not included in the primary key table. In order to fix this this problem, I can add a definition of this tax type to my sales tax type column. And then if I re-execute my insert statement, this will now work. So I get no error anymore. So this is an example of how we can implement data integrity using primary key and foreign key constraints. As you can see, this functionality and the syntax used is very similar to that used in Oracle. So in this demo, you've seen how we can create define a table with a primary key and use that primary key in a foreign key to validate our data. In the next demo, I will show you how we can provide a similar functionality using procedural integrity methods, so using triggers. So let's now discuss triggers. Both SQL Server and Oracle have after triggers. In SQL Server, there are no before triggers that are found in Oracle, but SQL Server has instead of triggers that are similar and can provide a similar functionality to the before triggers found in Oracle. Remember that in SQL Server, triggers are always at the statement level. So your trigger handles all the operations and all the data modifications performed by a single statement. Oracle, inside triggers in Oracle, you use pseudo row structures called new and old. In SQL Server, the same role is served by pseudo tables or special virtual tables called deleted and inserted. The deleted table has the before image of any modified row, and the inserted table has the after image of any rows that were modified. Unlike Oracle, where you can define the order of all the triggers that will fire on your table and how they should fire, in SQL Server, if you have multiple triggers per action, you can only define the first trigger to fire and the last trigger to fire. So the rest will fire in any order. It is very important to write your triggers in an efficient way and a way that is able to handle multi-row updates. You can never be sure if the operation that is executed against your table will affect one or more rows. And since SQL Server triggers are on the statement level, you have to keep in mind that every trigger you write is a multi-row trigger. So never assume there is just one row that you are processing. You always have to write multi-row triggers. Let me show you an example of how we define triggers and how we can use trigger to provide a similar functionality to that of the foreign key and enforce our data integrity using procedural methods inside a trigger. So in this second demo, I will drop the foreign key constraint that I have created in my previous demo. So I will no longer be enforcing the referential integrity between the sales tax rate and sales tax type using foreign keys. Now I want to do it procedurally in a trigger. So I will create a trigger on the sales tax rate for insert and for update, as these are the only two operations that require enforcing referential integrity in this case. And inside that trigger, I will select the number of rows. I will basically retrieve the number of rows from inserted table, which is my virtual table where the after image of any modified row is stored. And I will join the inserted table with my sales tax type table, the one that I'm referencing, on tax type column. If this is a left join, so if I find any rows where tax type is null, so where there were no matching rows found in the sales tax type table, that means I have a foreign key violation here, and therefore I will print an error message and roll back the transaction. So after I create a trigger like this, I can try to insert a row into my sales tax rate table using 5 for the tax type value. Such value is not found in my sales tax type column table. So if I try to insert this, the trigger will detect that there is a mismatch, that there is a row that does not have, that has illegal tax type value, and will roll back my transaction. So I get an error message printed from the trigger, and then I got the error message from the database engine itself that my transaction that started outside of the trigger ended in the trigger. So basically that we had a problem and a trigger rolled back that transaction. That stops execution of our batch. So if there were any additional updates later, they would not execute. This is basically the mechanism for canceling and rolling back a transaction inside a trigger. I can fix this problem by declaring an appropriate sales tax type with tax type 5, and now trying to perform the same operation, it will of course succeed. Now, if you have a choice between implementing your referential integrity constraints using foreign keys or triggers, of course, using the declarative method and using foreign key constraints is more efficient in terms of performance. However, it is not as flexible. So if you have some more complicated rules and constraints, triggers give you additional capabilities that you will not have in foreign key constraints. But for something as simple as in this scenario, you're probably better off using foreign key constraints as they have lower performance overhead. So in this demonstration, you've seen how you can enforce referential integrity using triggers. We've defined a trigger on one table and then verified the data inserted into that table against another table and committed and rolled back a transaction as needed. The next thing I would like to discuss is managing indexes and how you can manage indexes in both Oracle and in SQL Server. SQL Server and Oracle both have unique and non-unique non-clustered indexes. They are very similar in both platforms. SQL Server also very often uses clustered indexes. And clustered indexes are similar to the Oracle index organized table. So basically, the index is not separate from the table itself. The index is the table, and it is organized using that index into an appropriate B3, and the order of rows within that index is enforced according to the index definition. SQL Server indexes can be created, dropped, rebuilt, and reorganized either online or offline. The default behavior, of course, is for the index to be created offline, which means the access to the table while my index is being created is blocked. And all the queries, all the updates to that table would block for the duration of my index creation. It is also possible to perform those operations online, as long as you are using an Enterprise edition of SQL Server, Enterprise or a Developer edition of SQL Server. There, you have the ability to build indexes online. So without blocking concurrent access to your table, essentially you can perform updates to the table while the index is being built in the background. And that's a high availability feature. And we will talk about it a little bit more when we discuss high availability. It lowers the downtime and the amount of maintenance window that is required to perform your index operations. And you can perform them without disrupting normal database traffic and normal updates happening inside the database. Apart from normal relational indexes, SQL Server also offers two special types of indexes. One are spatial indexes that are created on any spatial data, such as geography or geometry, and they use tessellation to figure out where within a grid given shape resides. So they can be used to speed up certain queries where you look for shapes with a particular distance to another shape. Another type of non-relational index in SQL Server is an XML index. Whenever you store XML data inside your database, you can also create XML indexes on that data. Those XML indexes are a materialization of the XML infoset found in your XML data. It's a materialization of a node table describing each of the nodes within your XML documents. They tend to be very large, but they can provide tremendous performance benefits whenever you query for XML data with particular values or particular attributes. So depending on what type of XML queries you plan to be running against this XML data, there are three different types of XML indexes that you can create. And then finally, in SQL Server 2012, we have a new type of index that was added called column store index. That column store index changes the way we store our data. So rather than a traditional relational way where you store rows of data and every row is stored in its entirety with all the columns on a page, a column store index stores each column separately. So basically your row is broken down into columns and each segment, each data page stores a particular set, a particular column and all the values for that column from various rows. This enables two things. First of all, it provides much better compression thanks to the fact that values within a particular columns are much more likely to repeat, so they will compress much better. And on the other hand, it also provides a new way of executing queries, where rather than executing the entire execution plan and basically pulling a row by row through your execution plan, we have so-called batch mode execution, where you load a set of column values into your CPU cache and you run the operator on all those values at once. You basically run in a tight loop and you minimize the amount of memory access that needs to be performed during this operation. this column store index can provide tremendous performance benefits for certain types of queries, especially for data warehouse queries. As of SQL Server 2012 RTM, the column store indexes are read-only, so you cannot update the data. The main scenario for using the column store indexes is therefore in data warehouses, where you load the data into the data warehouse every now and then you can create the column store index to speed up all your reporting queries. The performance benefit is very often in the order of 100 times and more faster than using traditional indexes and traditional execution methods. Let me show you now an example of creating an index with so-called included columns and how it will benefit my query in SQL Server. So we will take a look at the execution plan before creating an index and after creating an index. I will also show you how we can rebuild that index online. So I have a query that queries my product inventory data. This query, as you can see, retrieves four columns from the product inventory table. Since currently there are no non-clustered indexes on this table that my query could use, the execution plan for my query involves a clustered index scan. And a clustered index scan, as we know, is essentially a table scan. So I need to scan the entire table to retrieve those four columns that I am interested in. Of course, the operator cost for this operation is large, and it might generate a large number of reads. I would like to optimize this query and speed it up by creating an index that this query could use. Such index, often called covering index, because it's an index that essentially covers your query, where you don't need to use the table itself, the clustered index, you don't need to resolve any row bookmarks. It basically covers your entire query. Your entire query can be fulfilled from that single index. So I would like to create a covering index for this query. Such an index would need to include all four columns that are found in my query. So I will need to have product ID, shelf, bean, and quantity in that index. There are two ways to create that index. I can, of course, do that from my management studio. So if I open my Object Explorer and navigate to table product inventory, I can create a new index here. There is just a clustered index right now, so I will create a new non-clustered index for this table. And I can choose what type of index it should be. So if we have a non-clustered index, it's not going to be unique, so I don't check the unique box. And I will add two columns that are interesting for us. I will add the shelf and the bin. So if I ever look for product ID for products based on their location, shelf and bin, I can easily use this index as well. So those two columns will be my key columns for the index. I will also include additional columns in that index. As we know, my query needs four columns. So I should probably include both the quantity and the product ID columns in this index. However, I know that the product ID column is a clustered index key for that table. And a clustered index key is always implicitly contained and included in any non-clustered indexes. So that means that the product ID will be included for me automatically, and I have to explicitly only include the quantity column. So with this, that will create an index that has two key columns and one included column with another column that is implicitly included. We might not see it here in the index definition, but we will be able to verify in just a moment that it's there. So if I click OK, the index has been created for me. I didn't really give it a meaningful name, but it doesn't matter in this case. So if I execute my query now, you can see that I am now scanning a non-clustered index. So it turns out that I don't really have to go and retrieve the entire table and query the entire table, because I can use this non-clustered index to provide all the data that is needed for my query. If I had a condition in my query, such as, for instance, a shelf and bean, so if I was looking for all the products on shelf A and bean shelf equals A and bean equals 1, then that index turns out to be even better, because I can perform an index seek looking for a particular shelf and a particular bean. And once I arrived at the right portion of the index, at the rows that fulfill my criteria, I will also have all the remaining columns that are used by my query. This method of optimizing queries by using covering indexes is one of the easiest and most effective ways to improve performance. If I wanted to create this index using Transact SQL, so let me drop it first. Here is an equivalent T-SQL definition of the index that I just created. So with shelf and bean as two index key columns, with the quantity as the included column, and I could say, for instance, that I want to perform an online build of this index. So I want this index to be built online without disrupting any modifications to the table, any normal traffic. Oops, wrong database. And here it is. I just created that index. I could also rebuild either this or all indexes on that table using alter index rebuild syntax. So in this case, I am rebuilding all the indexes on this table using a fill factor setting of 80, which means all the index pages will only be packed to 80% of their capacity, leaving the remaining 20% for any additional rows. So here's an example of how you can rebuild an index using Transact SQL. So in this demonstration, you have seen how we can create a multi-column composite index using both the Management Studio as well as Transact SQL, and how creation of this multi-column index with included columns improved performance of my query and provided a covering index for that query. Let's now talk about views. When it comes to views, both Oracle and SQL Server have essentially very similar basic view definitions. In Oracle, you can force creation of a view even if the base object that the view references do not yet exist. In SQL Server does not have such an option for views. However, it provides a similar option and similar behavior for stored procs, where creation of the stored proc will not check for existence of all the objects. There is so-called deferred name resolution, where the new newly created stored proc might be referencing objects that are not there yet. In SQL Server, you can also encrypt your stored proc and view definitions. That encryption is relatively weak and it's reversible, so you should be careful preventing or protecting your object definitions using with encryption option. In Oracle, views can have constraints defined and can be made read-only. You can also achieve similar behavior in SQL Server by creating triggers on your view. So you can have an instead of trigger on a view that could prevent operation from happening. You can also make an otherwise not updatable view into an updatable view by creating a instead of trigger on the view that would intercept and re-implement the update operation as needed. Creating instead of triggers on views provides us with a number of interesting options. SQL Server also offers so-called indexed views. Indexed views are equivalent of Oracle's materialized views. So by creating a clustered index on a view, I am essentially materializing the results of that view into a new B-tree, and that B-tree, that index, will be maintained automatically as the changes are performed against the based table. Let me show you how we can create and benefit from an indexed view and what type of query can be improved by using an indexed view. So the query that I will use, it's an aggregation query that grabs data from multiple tables and aggregates it by order date and product ID. So basically, it calculates the revenue that we get from a particular product on each date. So it has a complicated formula here, where the revenue is defined as the unit price times the order quantity minus any potential discounts. So this is an aggregation query, and if I run it right now, you will see that my execution plan involves joining of those two tables, performing aggregation, using hash match, performing sorting. Quite an expensive query, quite an expensive operation to calculate this ad hoc. So what if I wanted to improve the performance of this query by using an indexed view? In order to create an indexed view, there's a number of options that must have the right settings. So there are some prerequisites for how your indexed view will work and when you can create an indexed view. So I will make sure that all those options are in their right setting. And then I create a view using with schema binding option. And the schema binding option ensures that the view that is created is bound to the underlying schema so that the schema of the underlying tables cannot be modified in a way that would invalidate this view. My view joins sales order detail and sales order header, those two tables. It performs identical aggregation, and it also groups data by order date and product ID. In addition to the aggregation that was found in my query, I also have a count big aggregate function. This function has to be found in any data aggregation view that we intend to index. So if we are indexing any view, there, and the view is performing grouping, the count big function needs to be in our view definition. So I'm creating the view. Now, after creation of the view, nothing really happened. I just have a view that happens to have a similar definition to my query. So if I query the view, you can see that I get similar information, similar results to my original query, but the execution plan still indicates that I'm actually performing the query against the base tables. So that I'm gathering the data from the base tables, performing all the aggregation ad hoc. So the next step now is to create the index, to materialize my view by creating a unique clustered index. And the first index you create against an indexed view has to be unique clustered index. In this case, it is very easy to find a unique combination of columns. That unique combination of columns are the columns that we are grouping by in the index definition. So I create a unique clustered index on those two columns. Once I create my index, the view was essentially materialized. And I can now use this view to bypass the need to perform all the aggregations ad hoc. And the beauty of this scenario, and one of the magics of the SQL Server Query Optimizer, is that even though I'm not changing anything in my query, I still use the original query as it was. I'm not referencing the view directly. So again, no changes, just the same query. Just the fact that the view exists and the definition of that view matches the definition of the query, it aggregates the data in a similar way, will cause the query optimizer to match the query against the view. So when I execute, I no longer have two table scans, I no longer have those joins. Now my results are coming directly from the view. So you can see that I am now scanning a clustered index on a view. It says view clustered. So I already have the data joined and aggregated, and I just need to retrieve it from that view. And the query optimizer detects that automatically, and you can greatly improve performance of many queries without having to change anything about the query itself. So the query definition remained the same, but I could take advantage of the view. So in this demonstration, in this example, you've seen how we can create an indexed view and how we can benefit from performance that it brings to certain types of queries. So in this module, we have discussed the similarities and differences in managing some basic schema objects in Oracle and in SQL Server. We've covered tables, constraints, foreign keys, indexes, triggers, and views. Thank you very much for watching, and I encourage you to view module number 10, where we'll discuss managing database security.